welcome you. I would like to thank our programming partner, the Saskatchewan Environmental Society, and I think I will just hand with that. I will hand it over to. Please remind me of your name. Anne. Biodiversity and reduction of toxic substances in our environment. And if you're not already a member of SES, I encourage you to join. You can always find out more about our many interesting projects and how to get involved by checking out our website, www.environmentalsociety.ca, or just talk to me after tonight's presentation. So, our speaker this evening is Brian Brunskill. Brian is a professional geologist, and he is president of the Saskatchewan Geological Society. As a consultant, he has worked in the petroleum and potash mining industries in Saskatchewan since 1985. His work has included the assessment of deep saline aquifers for their geothermal heating potential. But since 2019, Brian has been investigating the potential use in Saskatchewan of compressed air storage of energy. And that's what he's going to tell us about this evening. I feel that because the argument is opening and the wind is blowing. So, Brian, we're very happy to welcome you tonight.
Thanks, Anna. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out. I'm pretty excited about this topic. I hope by the end of this you'll pick up a few tidbits and you might get excited too. Navigating things here. I'll give you a brief idea of what the outline of the presentation will look like. Getting myself oriented here. We'll talk about some of the transition challenges towards incorporating more renewables into our energy supply system and how that leads to the need for long-duration energy storage. I'm going to describe how compressed air energy storage, or CASE, works. And, of course, part of that is the use of salt caverns that are developed in the subsurface. And I'm going to describe very briefly how those caverns are created. And then maybe I'm going to kind of sum up with, right now I think there's three utility-scale energy options available to Saskatchewan, that being the availability of nuclear generation with SMRs, natural gas generation with associated carbon capture and storage, and renewables with compressed air energy storage. And I'm going to talk about some of the economics related to those three utility-scale generation potentials we have. And then we'll have an opportunity for some questions. many challenges as we try to incorporate renewables into the grid. All coal generation is slated to end by 2030, with the exception of the carbon capture unit at the Boundary Dam power facility. We're facing a carbon tax, aggressive carbon tax, to $107 a ton by 2030. And we're anticipating the elimination of natural gas for power generation by 2035 as well, unless there's associated carbon capture and storage. And Saskatchewan is to have about 50% generation capacity for renewables by 2030. This is a big task for Saskatchewan. It's reliant on fossil fuel use to make this transition with all these points is a huge hurdle for SaskPower and for us. So, as Ansel has said, one of the issues with renewable generation is that it's intermittent. And I'm going to show you how that is not the case in Saskatchewan because we have this technology available to us. And by having large-scale energy storage capacity, we can accommodate essentially unlimited renewable generation capacity. Right now, much of the wind and solar generation has to be backed by gas generation. That's just the reality we live in because it's intermittent. So this creates a real challenge for SaskPower to accommodate those periods when that renewable generation is not operating. It's a huge problem for them. So you have to have gas assets that can run up and down to accommodate that generation intermittency from renewables. And of course, these three technologies are worth looking at. I'm going to speak about CASE particularly. And of course, all three technologies have the potential to provide utility scale generation. But at what cost? Power has to be reliable and affordable. So where are our opportunities in Saskatchewan for renewable generation? For low carbon generation. We have very limited potential in southern Saskatchewan for more hydro. Pumped hydro, of course, is also very limited, especially in southern Saskatchewan. We can import more power from Manitoba and North Dakota. Saskatchewan is just developing a new tie line with North Dakota. Geothermal, like the Deep Earth Energy Project on the border south of Regina, is its early days. We still don't know how reliable that's going to be. And natural gas generation with carbon capture and storage, this is what SaskPower is advancing, is more gas generation. They've built a new plant, Swift Current, one that's being completed in Moose Jaw. I believe there's more planned for the future. With potentially, I'm not speaking for them here, but I'm guessing that in order for these assets to not become stranded, they're going to have carbon capture and storage. And of course, we have the potential for SMRs. They're several years away. They will be like a coal plant, I assume. They'll want to operate at a very level generation capacity. They won't want to ramp up and down, or they lose significant efficiencies. And of course, there's a number of social license issues around nuclear that have not been resolved in Saskatchewan. And we have our renewable resources, like wind and solar. You've seen versions of this kind of map before, where essentially this is a wind map on the left and a solar map on the right. I don't need to get into details, except that the warmer colors really represent significant generation potential. There's Saskatchewan, so with wind generation has significant potential, as well as the solar output. So we have these raw resources that are free and inexhaustible available to us right in Saskatchewan. So how can we take advantage of that? This chart here shows wind generation from two different wind generating facilities in Alberta over the first week in January and the first week in June. And again, without getting into the meat, but really what I'm just showing you is how spiky it is. And when a generator like SaskPower looks at that, it just boggles them, because how do we deal with that? We have to have assets. We're going to generate this kind of electricity from renewables. We have to have a means to fill in the gaps when it's not available. Tremendous challenge for them. So this brings us to renewable generation and energy storage. This is how we can get over this conundrum. Right now, solar and wind generation are the cheapest forms of new electricity and are available today and have zero emissions, direct emissions. Technically, facilities, of course, have emissions. Both solar and wind generation are intermittent and require energy and storage in order to smooth that generation profile so they can follow the load, smoothing it and follow the load as it moves up and down on a moment-by-moment basis in the province. It's not like you just turn everything on and let it run. These assets are moving up and down as the day changes, these fluctuating periods. So to facilitate the inclusion of renewables, we need long-term energy storage. This is just a sample chart of a 24-hour period along the bottom here, for any particular day, and energy generation load on the left. This double line represents what would base load would be, and that's largely where our coal generation is providing right now, and some hydro, but predominantly coal. But the dashed brown line represents what the grid demand is, and of course it's going up, and that's a very smooth outline. In reality, that's much choppier. But you can see as the so it's this area above base load that right now most of that is covered by hydro generation, where they can essentially open the water and down, or they can or gas assets, they can ramp up gas assets. So if we add a renewable energy provision on top of that, this could be wind or solar, you can see that at times it's a few things. First of all, it doesn't cover anything under the grid demand in this brown area here. And at the same time, it's producing more, potentially producing more energy than what's actually needed above the brown line. This is often the case. We don't see it in Saskatchewan because our wind assets, particularly wind assets, aren't as large, as well developed as other jurisdictions. This is a common problem in Alberta, California, Ontario, where they have large scale renewable generation now. So there's these gaps here, and there's excess here. And this excess is typically curtailed. So you have this capital asset of wind chargers. They're operating. There's nowhere to send the electricity. Southern Ontario essentially gives this electricity to Michigan in some instances. So what do we do with this excess? If we take that excess energy and put that into storage later in the generation cycle, we can use it from storage to smooth this power provision. So now we're actually filling that gap. We can actually follow that load, because once the electricity is in storage, it can be released, so to speak, to follow that demand curve. And again, this varies on a moment by moment basis. These little dashed lines here at the bottom represent, as we build out more and more renewable infrastructure, we can actually start to contribute. We're actually emulating base load now. In this case, we're actually emulating base load with wind generation. I use wind as a proxy. I mean wind and solar, but wind is available in the wintertime as well, and it's available at night. So solar will have a role to play, but mostly this will be wind generation. So we have a little bit of this kind of thing going on in Saskatchewan right now. This combined wind and solar energy facility just outside of Regina. This started with a wind charger, I forget when, it's been several years now, and the solar panels were added a couple of years ago, and there's on-site batteries. This is an SRC managed project to see how this might work. So the batteries are charged, and at a certain time during the generation cycle, that electricity is put into the grid, and then they're recharged. This is a much bigger version. This is the Tesla 100 megawatt power plant system in South Australia, where there's a wind field charging these batteries. This is actually quite almost live now. It's probably at least 3 years old. There's lots more of these going on. So batteries, of course, can provide complementary storage. Batteries are still a good thing. They're fast. The life cycle is simple, and they can follow that load needed because they're so fast to respond. They have their role, especially if there's during startup periods. That power is available right away, whereas a gas or even what I'm going to talk about, a case asset, they're slower to start up. They have to ramp up. Batteries are great for that. The life cycle is simple. Bill Jarge discharge. It's a chemical storage technology, of course, requiring minerals and metals like lithium and cobalt and a number of other things. And mining waste must be considered, and the energy and waste with recycling must be considered. And I'm not sure we have a competent recycling program in place yet. We're so busy trying to find more and make more. Interestingly, this is just a side comment, but I'm not sure what we're going to do with all the lithium when the next battery technology comes along. Because we have lithium, it's just, this is the evolution of power. And of course, as the technology per kilowatt hour is improving, the market geopolitical risks are significant with lithium mining and that kind of thing. There's lots of interest in developing this in Canada and other places. Very dynamic right now. But it'll come down to the actual cost of materials. It'll be the major price for batteries. This left-hand side, this is a megawatt. It speaks to the size of the capacity of the generating unit. And across the bottom is the megawatt hours, which is the energy related to how long they would last. And you can see the battery technology occupies this bottom left section in general. Compressor storage is in the other side of the thing, in the upper right corner, which speaks to its long duration and high energy. There's lots of power. They can be built for the same capacity as natural gas facilities right now. I guess a couple of points. The lithium is useful for peaking operations. But the cost also of the batteries is significant, and there's very little economy of scale. So on a double battery capacity, you have to have twice as many batteries. Whereas with the compressed air storage, we're going to talk about, still going to be talking about, capacity can decrease insignificantly with a modest increase in capital cost. So how does compressed air energy storage work? In this situation, we've got wind and solar generation going directly to the grid. If we have additional, that electricity would otherwise have to be curtailed. When we have excess generation, that electricity is used to run a compressor, which charges atmospheric air and puts that air into rock salt caverns, purpose-built caverns in the subsurface. It's just natural air, atmospheric air. In the generation cycle, when that electricity is required, that air is released in a controllable fashion and is passed through a generation turbine, and that electricity goes to the grid as well. This is not new technology. The operation on the left is a 290 megawatt unit from Huntorf, Germany. It's been in operation since 1978. I'm in direct contact with some consultants that worked on that work, and other than the first two or three years, they had a number of operational problems they had to get over. This was the first one built in the world. But since then, like since the early 80s, it's been operating with great reliability and durability, and considering expansion at this point. On the right is a smaller unit at McIntosh, Alabama, where this has been in operation since 1991. Similar kind of thing. This plant is actually remotely operated. And so we have over 70 years of operational experience with this technology. So it's not an emerging technology, it's a mature technology. We'll dig in a little bit deeper here now. There's two types of compressor energy storage systems. The diabatic compressor storage is an example. Both the unit in Huntorf, Germany and Alabama are these types of units where during the charging process, the compressor is operating, compressors create a lot of heat, and that heat is just rejected to the atmosphere. And so that air is lost. So that heat is lost, rather. During the charging stage, when that air is released out of the cavern, a small amount of natural gas is added. That prevents the You can imagine an amazing significant pressure reduction, so there's good potential for icing up, that kind of thing. So natural gas is added at that point, adds some extra heat, as well boost for generation. So, although there are this kind of system, sorry, maybe I'll stop. This would be the modern version of the compressed air facility. It's called a Medivac system, and that's where the heat from compression air is stored. Rather than just losing that to the atmosphere, it is directly stored. And during the generation side of things, when the cavern is discharging, that heat is added back. That avoids the use of natural gas, in which case we're generating now electricity that's as a renewable source, and there's zero greenhouse gas emissions. Now, I work as a geologist. We've got to have a little bit of geology here, too. This colorful map shows the presence where we have subsurface salt in Saskatchewan. And of course, it's within the salt that we mine potash and for chromite, so you're familiar with the presence of salt. If we were to just go straight down beneath this, there's a this map represents the surface of that salt. So Saskatoon is about a kilometer beneath us, and Regina is about 1,600 meters beneath us. So you can see as the colors get warmer, it just represents it's getting deeper and deeper. The stars represent where we have salt caverns that have been created. The first one, Mel Building, in 1958. So we have clusters like that. Asquith, for example, I think there's three or four caverns at Regina. There's about a dozen of them or more. Melville, there's several. Altogether, there's 58 caverns that have developed. So this is not a new technology for Saskatchewan. We know how to build caverns, and we know where to build them. We have a very good, and how to manage them, of course. We have all this experience. If we took the crust on its side, this is what's called a stratigraphic section, cross-section. And what this shows are these different pancakes of rocks, so to speak, that are stacked one on top of the other. We're particularly interested in the prairie salt, this big, thick pink section. These are names of just other rocks, which could be a limestone or sandstone, a number of different kinds of rock types. But it's this big pink section, which is predominantly sodium chloride. Green ones at the top represent, in most areas, there's some potash, which is potassium chloride. And there's a number of other salts that are within that prairie salt. But we're looking for nice, clean, optimally, we get nice, clean sodium chloride in which to target how to build a cavern. So these caverns are developed by using solution mining techniques, where after an exploration program, if we had an ideal location for a soup disk, we'd have an exploration program to figure out what the quality of the salt would be. So we look at all the information we have available to us from the drilling of other wells and other operations, and running things like three-dimensional seismic to see if there's any. This is a very simple picture. The salt's a little more complicated than that. But try to narrow down the most ideal conditions for cavern development. And at that point, we would drill a well into the salt, and then we have mining methods where we essentially circulate fresh water into that salt, and of course it naturally dissolves that salt. So we inject fresh water and then pump it back out. And we've learned how to create these caverns to kind of control the geometry and the shape by different mining methods of making the ideal shape. So they get built to the size as appropriate and the shape. And of course, we're in the process of doing this, we're creating a very large volume of what's called brine, which is very salt-rich water. We're putting fresh water into that cavern, into that space, and we're pumping out very salty water. Well, it's toxic, nasty, we have to get rid of it. We're also more geological blessings in Saskatchewan. We have these other aquifers, deep aquifers, this deadwood aquifer, that's a deep aquifer that's full of water that's already salty for the most part. Some shallower ones in the Manville. These are different, depending on where we are in the province, both these varieties have been used by many of those potash, the cavern development areas. So in this case, the brine is just injected into the Precambrian mantle. So we can dispose of it in a safe way. The water itself never barely sees the surface, comes to the surface, and right away is pumped back down to the deep subsurface where it can cause no harm. And of course, once we have infrastructure in place, we can start adding additional caverns. And this is not unlike what they've done at various fields around Aspen, again, as an example, where they've developed several caverns to store natural gas. This is a sonic image of the cavern at Aspen to give you an idea of the dimensions. This one's about 5 million cubic feet in size. You can see it's a regular shape, but it's they drop a special tool inside the cavern that's full of water, salt water, and can take a sonic image and create these kinds of images to see what they look like and what their shapes are. Here's this map again with the caverns located. And so this is where we have a great deal of knowledge already. Kind of the ideal depth for a compressed air storage facility is between 800 and 1200 meters, and that's pretty represented by a corridor about 150 kilometers wide that essentially comes through Melville, through Saskatoon, up to Westminster. This is a primary area for compressed air storage development. They can be developed deeper, but there's just more operational challenges. The pressures are larger. I've laid over here the major transmission routes for Sask Power, and you can see that there's lots of overlap between major transmission and where we have salt caverns, and where we have this gross body of salt. The potential is very significant to tie in existing infrastructure with salt cavern development. I mean, if we can avoid creating more infrastructure, more carbon transmission lines are very expensive to build. So these are just two features that show us the advantage we have in terms of existing infrastructure. So, CASE is an excellent storage opportunity for Saskatchewan. It's a very small surface area because all the infrastructure is underground, the caverns are underground, the geology is well understood. We have over 170,000 wells in Saskatchewan, so we have a very good idea of the subsurface. And we've been operating caverns since 1958. We have a high-scale oil field and industry trades, scientists and engineers that live here. We have a regulatory structure in place with the regulation of natural gas and other hydrocarbons in these caverns, and we're just storing atmospheric air. So the regulatory infrastructure is largely in place. And I believe that wind, particularly, and CASE, our storage can potentially emulate old generation successful. And there's no toxic waste with CASE or legacy disposal or reclamation issues. This is a wonderful part of this technology. And we have a number of high quality sites that are available to us. We have to find them. It's not like we can do this anywhere. We have to find them and work towards that. But we have all these options that we have. We have great geology and we have great renewable resources available to us. If we look particularly at wind plus CASE, we have excellent cheap feedstocks, inexhaustible feedstocks, and they're the cheapest source of new energy generation now available. I'll just read that up. So with storage, we can facilitate large-scale renewable generation. This is kind of a self-affirming loop. Each 300 megawatt CASE facility requires the supply of approximately 900 megawatts of wind generation. That has to be available. So if you have lots of wind generation, you need lots of CASE. If you have lots of CASE, you need more wind generation. So it feeds itself, so both industries get developed at the same time to increase that capacity with the idea of eventually emulating coal generation. So if we were to build several of these units, like right now I think there's 1,400 megawatts of coal that needs to be replaced. If that was four of these units, we're looking at maybe 3,500 to 4,000 megawatts. That's literally hundreds of 5 megawatt wind chargers to fulfill that gap. And we and we have the resources in Saskatchewan to do that. Incidentally, the diabetic case system that's being used in Germany and Alabama, if we were to build one of those new now, it would be cost competitive with new combined cycle gas generation while providing 80% reduction in CO2 emissions. Right now, we can do this. We have this technology available to us right now. And the adiabatic system is more expensive than the diabatic because we have technology to store that heat. It's more expensive, but now we're taking it from an 80% reduction to 100% reduction. So the industries are supporting each other. With storage, we can install massive amounts of wind and solar generation while rapidly reducing our emissions. I spoke a little earlier about the three utility scale power generation sources that we have access to in Saskatchewan would be SMRs, combined cycle gas turbines with carbon capture, and compressed air energy storage. These are these three technologies. If we just look at capital cost, the information for the SMRs and the combined cycle with the SMRs is from the SMR roadmap with NRCan and the various provinces. The carbon capture and storage is with combined cycle is from the USIE capital cost performance characteristics. And the third is from developing, the diabatic is from a developer, a case developer in Calgary that's interested in trying to pursue an operation in Saskatchewan. So this is all these are all different sources of information, so it's difficult, we have to be careful when we compare things. But it gives us a good start, and it gives us a real broad brush of what the costs of these technologies are. And why this is important is because, carbon emissions aside, what's this energy going to cost us? Whatever size power, for example, has to, whatever their cost of electricity generation is, that's going to be reflected on what we pay for it. And industry and all the ratepayers are from the province. So the averaging quite a bit of information, I came up with about a $3 billion capital cost for the very first of its kind SMR in Saskatchewan. And then in March of this year, Minister Morrison said it's likely to be more like $5 billion. All these are for a 300 megawatt facility. Combined cycle with carbon capture, and that's just up to the fence, it doesn't include the storage element, about $950 million for a 300 megawatt. The diabatic case, which is very comparable to what's built in Germany, $775 million, and the adiabatic, about $850 million. So these are startling numbers, in my opinion. Capital cost will be part of the story, of course. The levelized cost of electricity, the LCOE, that's probably the more relative number because that's an accounting method way of normalizing everything. We can fairly compare different industries and different sources of electricity. So, the first of its kind SMR, $52 to $110 per megawatt. We're unsure what the additional capital cost would actually be. SaskPower is not forthcoming right now in terms of what the levelized cost will be. And maybe they don't know yet, but they think they have some kind of an idea. Combined cycle gas turbine generation carbon capture, $80 to $140 million. Diabetic case, $72 to $94 million. Adiabatic, 91 to 114. These are the numbers that actually matter more than those. But this is still quite startling. And there is reference in this document. These numbers are also cushioned with a statement that says some of these numbers were relied upon by a future technology that has yet been disclosed or has yet been developed. What does that mean? Anyway, these numbers are all very significant. And again, it's not a fair comparison because my level of investigation is not very deep, and it's from a number of different sources, but it paints a general picture of what I'm trying to get across now. So some summary points to consider. The timing, we all know there's urgency for developing renewable resources. Wind and gas is simple, cost effective, and can be used to actually emulate coal generation as available now. It can be scaled from 160 to 320 megawatt capacity, providing from 18 to 60 hours of generation capacity. The new plant at Swift Current and Lushard and Inlet 350 megawatt size plant for comparison. In terms of economic development, this is a similar story for any of these projects. For any time there's a large capital infrastructure project where there's lots of construction jobs and a large injection of cash into local economies. This is the other piece. So that each facility would require the construction of about 900 megawatt capacity of wind generation, which would be developed by third parties in rural Saskatchewan. And each one of those would inject about $1 billion into the rural economy. And of course, CASE technology can contribute to ESG requirements to helping developing industry to lower their footprint, their greenhouse gas emission per unit of product that they're making. And of course, the generation cost, which I made a point of before, will be determined. Whatever the generation cost is for SaskPower in this case, will be directly related to what we have to pay as ratepayers. So if our objective is to deploy technologies to significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions with the lowest cost to consumers, there's those three major technologies I've spoken of. Carbon capture and storage, a levelized cost and such, it replies. It also relies on imported natural gas. We import about half the gas in Saskatchewan now from Alberta, our friendly neighbors, that's fine, but we have the capacity to use our own local renewable resources. SMR is an unproven technology, really, at this level in Saskatchewan, and has a very high capital cost, and we're unsure what the levelized cost of electricity is. Whereas compressed energy storage with renewables is a mature technology. The levelized cost is at 81 to 102, just compared to those numbers. You know from the previous chart, that's the lowest on the chart. And it uses unlimited cheap Saskatchewan renewable fuel and creates significant economic activity in rural Saskatchewan. So, what do you think? That's my presentation. So if you have any questions, I'd be delighted to try it out. Yes?
On how the fresh air system actually creates electricity. You create, say, from wind, you get wind, you create electricity, and then you convert that into fresh air. How does that work?
Well, you use the electricity generated from a wind farm, for example. You use that electricity to run a compressor that compresses atmospheric air into the cab. And then later, when you need that electricity, you let the air out, and that air actually turns the turbine to generate power.
So you're basically storing the electricity in the pressure of the air.
That's right. You turn it into the kind of energy that's available from within the scatter. Yeah.
Is there a significant loss of fresh water in this brine that's created and then injected into Precambrian or whatever kind of rock there is?
Yes. There's, I think the ratio is between 3 and 5 to 1. So if you have a 5 million cubic foot cavern, you probably have 20 million cubic feet of fresh water that would be lost. You take it out of the hydrologic cycle on surface, that would be exposed in the subsurface.
And that is lost.
That water's no longer available.
And I can't imagine how much that is. Is that a significant loss to provincial fresh water supplies?
I don't think so. I don't think so. I don't have the numbers handy, but when you consider the amount of water that's close to the same process with potash mining, on an ongoing basis, it would be minuscule. Yeah. It is certainly, that could certainly be accounted for.
Hi, we have a couple questions on Facebook.
Sure.
About your presentation. So the first one is, how did you determine a 900 megawatt threshold for a wind facility? required for 300 case facility?
The if you think of these caverns, they're never really full or empty. It's a very dynamic system. They're filling. They can be filling for a few hours because generation is happening for a few hours. And when generation drops off, they could be stagnant, or they could actually start to generate power. All trying to follow that load. So in order to have enough capacity in storage to kind of weather through a heat wave where there's no generation for a week or something like that, according to the people that model this stuff, that's how you account for a long duration storage, is by having a large generation capacity. I hope that's clear enough.
The second question is, why were caverns developed?
They're developed all over the world where the salt is present and suitable. They've been used predominantly for natural gas storage and other things. They're used for propane and butane, a number of things. In Saskatchewan, we have coal winters, and we have, limited pipeline capacity. So when it's 40 below in Regina or Saskatoon, there may not be enough pipeline capacity coming into the city to satisfy the load. So during the summer months, they have these caverns, which are charged with natural gas, and they're like a big storage container. And then in the winter time, when the load really increases, for when we all crank our furnaces up, that gas is right on site, and it can be fed right in the grid for domestic consumption. So there's some here in Regina, some here in Saskatoon, near York, and Melville. They tend to be near pipeline infrastructure and wherever the
One more. Can you talk about the suitability of salt rock formations for caves versus other rock formations? Could you talk about the suitability of salt rock formations for caves versus other rock formations?
Okay, well, one of the differences of salt that you can imagine as a large, massive object, salt is impermeable. So when we create these caverns, there's nowhere for whatever's inside the natural gas or air to leak, because it's just great. Salt is very, 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 very tight, so it doesn't, unless there's a crack somewhere or there's some other mechanical failure, it's a very good container for air or natural gas, which is another gas. Other media like sandstone, they're not bound. They might have the space in there to inject air or natural gas. And sometimes natural gas is used in these kinds of aquifers, where it's injected, but it's a porous media that is unbound, so it's difficult to pressure up. These sandstone aquifers are used for gas storage, where the gas is injected and then it's returned. But with compressed, if you want to compress something, you have to have a hard boundary on the outside. And that's what the salt is great. Just, and incidentally, with that in mind, with all this additional generation capacity with renewables, this technology feeds directly into the eventual inclusion of hydrogen storage. Because if we have renewable generation, we can now be making green hydrogen rather than blue hydrogen from natural gas. We can make them both, but we can, by making green hydrogen, it will have to be done on a utility scale, which is a big scale, so we also have the capacity for utility scale storage, which takes us back to caverns. And hydrogen is stored in caverns now in other places in the world. I really don't want to disparage like nuclear or CCS. It's just that we probably need them all. We can have them all. And I think by having them all, it provides redundancy, and it provides some durability and different technologies you can rely on, because all these technologies are fairly new. Case is not, but SMRs and CCS is fairly new. So if we can, and we're so used, it's so easy just to turn the gas on. It's so reliable, but we're replacing that with a number of other things. So all three of these technologies can help us. I just kind of like.
I just had a question about the economics. When you look at cost of the case option. Does that include the cost of, say, the wind power that feeds the case system?
No, it doesn't. That's a separate cost.
So shouldn't that be included? Well, this impact when you're comparing the
cost? It's a good argument, but we have to then, if we're going to do that, like I kind of put a fence around a case facility,
yeah,
or an SMR or carbon capture.
Right.
If we're going to include the generation cost of electricity, to be fair, we have to then compare the cost of recovery of drilling and recovering gas,
right,
or mining for uranium.
Yeah.
So if we're going to go, we have to know where to cut it off. Okay. So if we want to go full life cycle of all of them, that sounds pretty complex, but that would be certainly good work to do. The full life cycle.
Got it. And my other question, could you just go back to that earlier question about loss of water? Mm-hmm. How does that loss of water happen?
Well, when we make a cavern, we're bringing salt water to surface. That water has to come to surface.
Yeah.
And then right away it goes into another well that goes, yeah, down into that deep aquifer.
Right.
And that's how it's disposed of.
Yeah, but this is not fresh water.
It wouldn't be fresh to begin with, because you need fresh water to dissolve the salt. So we'd be using surface potable water, river water, for example, or municipal water, to create the cavern, and then that water would be under the hydrologic cycle. Yeah. Yes?
So I have lots of thoughts going on in my head, but I'll try to express them and ask a few questions. So as I'm going through your presentation, it all seems just too good to be true, and I'm wondering what the downsides are, and so then fresh water seems to be one issue, but if we can use existing caverns, then that sort of, you know, checks that box that a whole, and maybe using fresh water isn't as big of a problem, because maybe we could just use some caverns that are already existing. So then it gets me to thinking, so on our farm, we actually disconnected from gas more than 10 years ago and put in geothermal, and we've done solar and wind power. So I understand then that the next hurdle, so if you, let's say, were to use a natural gas cavern, right, we want to eventually get away from natural gas, but then the problem is everybody's houses are still needing natural gas, right, so it will require everybody to transition, mm-hmm, turn off their natural gas and switch to some form of electric heat. So I guess, kind of, well, I guess I'm wanting to weigh in on some of those things, but then I wonder if this is so good and it's proven technology, why aren't we using it? What are the hurdles? And I hope you're talking to SAS Power and getting supporters for all. This group is there to support you, I think.
Well, the last question, I think it's unfamiliarity. Like, not very many of us, I forget what it's like to be a geologist sometime, because I've spent time looking at the subsurface that I'm not familiar with. Not many people are. It's a mystery to most people what's beneath us. That there's so many different characteristics of different kinds of rocks that are beneath us that, to a large degree, have created so much wealth in the province. We have oil and coal and gas and potash and uranium, all these things, all these resources are from our geology. But most folks don't really have a clear understanding of what does that mean. But for me, it's second nature because I've been working in my whole career. So I think it's knowledge is one thing. So if you're And it's fear of the unknown, and it's another part of it is, this is the way I do it, this is the way I like to do it, and this is the way I'm going to keep going. So we all are subject to that. Your first question about caverns, why we couldn't use gas. These caverns are very valuable, and it's unlikely that an existing cavern would be available to purchase or acquire, because they're very valuable as a storage asset. And if they are available, like they eventually, some of them do fail, they start to leak. Same things can happen when they start to leak. And at that case, there's no longer the ability to use it. You can't use it to compress stuff in, like natural gas or other hydrocarbons or air. And at that time, usually those caverns are converted for industrial waste. Like often oil-filled waste is often used in these old caverns. So that's what happens to them. So it's unlikely that one would become available, and if it did, it's probably got some problems. The other question is, really, this is natural gas is the example we use. That's what we have experience with, operating cavern. But really, I'm not talking about gas for
cut that off and switch to using electricity. And so it just seems to me that so far this is just being proposed as a solution to generate more electricity, which maybe our appetites are already voracious and we need to actually be thinking about conserving energy. And,
sure.
Right? So it just doesn't seem like then it's the solution to the problem if we're not looking at actually getting off of our addiction to natural gas or heating.
Sure. Big issue. This is just one hopeful piece of the puzzle. Because really, we're going to need all these technologies. We may need SMRs, I'm not sure. From my perspective, I'm kind of ambivalent towards the technology. I just want to get to it. If SMRs can play a role in reducing emissions significantly, unfortunately, won't be soon, they may have a role to play. Because that's the primary issue, is reducing emissions. So I don't know how that plays. I just have a quite good confidence in this technology because it's been around for. So there's different operating pressure regimes based on the depth. Because the deeper they are, the warmer the salt is, so it's even more plastic. Plus it has this capacity to flow. So you counteract that by having a minimal pressure in the cavern. And that's really variable depending on the depth and location. Sorry, I can't get the R wrong what pressure is. I'd probably be wrong.
Several bar.
Yeah, let's just say it's quite high pressure. If you're really so tight that it holds stuff in there under tremendous pressure. Yes?
I mean, I think this is amazing, and what's even more amazing in my view is that I've never heard of it. And I'm always reading the news and I'm thinking about climate crisis that we're in and the possible solutions. And I just think, right, because my little brain goes to nefarious. I think there must be something that is not bringing this figure to the surface, right? We hear about SMRs, and we hear about hydro, we hear about, but you know, the story is we don't have, that these renewables don't provide base load electricity, whatever that means. And, you know, I have a bit of an idea. But it's pretty straightforward that we need some kind of cheap storage solution. Mm-hmm. And this matches that.
Yeah.
So why aren't we hearing about this? I mean, we have to come to the library with these 20 billion
at times you have too much electricity, other times you don't have enough. So they figured out that in Huntsdorf that while we try to compress air, we can levelize the flow. So that's what generated was the need for storage from big power plants. So compressor storage technology kind of dropped off after that because I think it's because of the surge of natural gas generation. So there was, we didn't need to think about storage anymore because gas can ramp up, you know, much more easily to follow that bill. And there's lots of gas. And in the last 20 years, a lot of gas has come on screen globally. So there was, we weren't thinking about storage. And renewables were irritant because they create this uncertainty. And they have to be backed up by gas in order to penetrate the grid. So it really, it's just waking up, I think, to the real need for long-term storage.
I think the real money that is in our uranium industry here, and I've heard from leadership in there actually disparaging comments about the fluctuating nature of renewables. And I think that narrative gets out there, you know.
Well, there's maybe a bit of protectionism there, I'm not sure.
Well, sure, lots of money too, and so that speaks.
That's a good speculation. But yes, I agree. It's just not part of the conversation, so that's why we're here, is getting into the conversation. So you think it's a good idea? Yes.
Brian, bit of a pedestrian type question, but the storage facility, does it have to be located close to the source of the energy that's being generated, be it wind or solar? Does it have to be really close, or could it be quite distance?
Saskatchewan grid is quite well interconnected. So really, you're better off to locate one of these facilities near the local. So you could have one outside of Saskatoon, for example. If Saskatoon chose to get onto the renewable, they want their city to be generated by renewable power, they could be involved. They could, a facility could be located near here. And that facility would draw power off the grid. And even though that new generation might become from Wolseley or Assiniboine, that's put onto the grid, it can be taken off the grid at the facility. Because on the generation side, we're talking about lots more electricity. That we want that to be here to minimize transmission lines. So it makes sense to put it near where we're going to use it. Industrial facility or 300, I think Saskatoon probably got a 300 megawatt, 250, 300 megawatt power plant would satisfy the power of Saskatoon, the city of Saskatoon.
So to summarize what you said, you put it close to your users, but you could have a wind farm in Alberta that's going into the grid and you're storing it here in Saskatoon.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, there's economics and all that involved,
yeah,
because there's conversion
sure.
fees and things
yeah.
like that, tariffs. And I don't know if the business case might look at that, but at a high level, technically, that's possible. Yeah.
Okay.
I believe it's possible.
I just thinking about your SMR numbers, and it seems to me that the other options don't have that long-term radioactive waste, but that's not, dealing with waste is not part of your numbers there, is that correct?
No. Not even with carbon capture. That's, again, that's just a defense. That doesn't include the storage asset for, I mean, that too, if we use boundary down as an example, that carbon dioxide is stored in a deep aquifer as well. This doesn't include those costs.
When we talked about long-term storage, I think you indicated that it could go up to a month. If you needed to store for longer than that, can that work?
Well, I'm not sure how that's getting further out. I'm not as familiar how that would work, but you can increase capacity by having additional caverns.
Yeah.
So I think modeling, and that's what I'm hoping for, is that we can have a comparative assessment of these technologies in Saskatchewan,
yeah.
full life cycle cost, and put them side by side fairly, see what they look like. My numbers might not be true at all, because I'm looking from a number of different sources. But I think there's enough evidence there to say, let's do a side-by-side comparison to see what they look like, and maybe a third-party comparison. Yeah.
How long have you been using these arrows as storage for natural gas?
Well, it started in 1958, at Malibu, and I think some of those original ones, I don't know the number of them that have since failed and abandoned, but I know that there's, like, Transgas, our utility that does this. They're interested in developing more caverns as old ones fail or they're just too small, or a number of other things can happen. I don't understand right now. I don't work in that industry, so. But we have some of those older caverns are still operating.
But even that far down the car, so
yeah. I believe so. I'm an inventory exactly where we have hunting loss, because there hasn't been new caverns built for quite some time.
Well, if they're using the storm natural gas, they've been doing it for that long, you have to have a pretty good reliability record.
Yeah, or they'd stop doing that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, store natural gas, it's certainly still there.
Yes.
So, moving forward, this was really informative, but are there any proposals that you're aware of, like to build any of these in Saskatchewan, or?
Well, SaskPower is a utility we have. They're aware of the technology, and they're interested in it, but they may be doing some work internally, I'm not sure, but they haven't. They haven't said anything about wanting to develop. I think they're very focused on developing gas assets. But I don't know what's going on internally with them. Because it's a monopoly, there's no opportunity really. It would be complicated for an outside third party to develop one of these things because SaskPower runs everything. If you look at Alberta, for example, it's a gold market. There's this whole different situation from business.
So knowledge is power, right? And so the more people that know about it can write letters and ask the right questions and hopefully put a buzz in people's ear, maybe? I don't know. Like that's what I'm now thinking is, right? Like, what's the next step to pursue some of this or make this happen in our province?
Well, this is the next step. What we're doing tonight.
Are there plans in Alberta or other provinces?
They're looking at it as well. There's several operators in Alberta are looking at this as well. Yeah. Lots of places. This March, last spring, China opened up their first one. Started their first one. Don't know any details about it. It's pretty quiet, but they did make an announcement that they have a facility.
So there is currently a facility in Canada?
No, there's only the two. Well, that's not quite true. There's some small demonstration sites in Ontario. They use a different kind of technology. They use water as a ballast instead of air. It's still related to compressed air, but without complicating things, I wasn't going to say too much about them. There's quite a bit of interest in the States. There's three or four major operators. One was a Canadian called Hydrostore that is trying to develop some projects in essentially abandoned gold tin mines in Utah, where they use that underground cavern to store air as well. So there's a few different twists on this, depending on what the geology dictates. At the end of the day, you have to have an entire type of cavern void in the earth to do something for this to move the energy to convert that mechanical, convert that energy to.
Does Alberta have a salt formation like we have?
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Maps. You just see where that just grew right into Alberta.
Yeah.
Just catches the corner to Manitoba here too, in South Dakota, North Dakota.
Yeah.
So there's none in the north?
No.
Okay.
No, we kind of run out of, like here's LaRange about here, we kind of run out of sedimentary rocks altogether there.
Right.
Or that's the shield. probably about 160 megawatts would be a starting point for a generating plant. Because we're using the same, it's using all the same big turbo equipment that generation facilities are using, combined cycle gas units are. So that would be entry level, about 160 megawatts. That's pretty big. That's utility scale again. But that farmer's generation from the solar panels could go into the grid. So that if it's fully charged and has the capacity to generate 8 or 10 megawatts, that's going to be spent in a number of hours. It's just no, there's no amount of volume of batteries. So if you want to increase that load or that capacity, you have to increase more and more batteries, and it's better than the economy of scale of that. Of course, the idea with the case facility is that you can add additional capacity by creating additional caverns. And once your infrastructure is in place, adding that additional cavern, you can significantly increase the load with a fire at less than 20%. Essentially, significantly increasing the capacity at a very marginal rate. Once all that infrastructure is in place, you've got the disposal well, you've got all the infrastructure to create caverns. To now start creating additional caverns, becomes less and less expensive. Batteries. Any more?
I think you've convinced us.
Well, thanks, everyone. This is.